Ambassador Ann Wagner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for hosting this hearing. And I'll echo my colleagues. I cannot think of a more fitting way for you to close out your esteemed time and leadership on this committee than to reflect on the immense progress we have seen in relations between the United States and our African partners, and to chart paths towards future shared growth. Ambassador Naj, I am deeply concerned about China's attempts to expand its control over the global cobalt market to African producers. It has recently come to my attention that China is now seeking to derail a U.S.-Cameroonian memorandum of understanding on cobalt production. This strikes me as a serious national security risk. Already, the U.S. military buys most of the cobalt it uses for guided missiles production from China. And frankly, a partnership on cobalt production with Cameroon would greatly benefit both countries. How is the State Department working with the Cameroonian government to get the memorandum of understanding back on track?
Thank you for the question. Unfortunately, I am not familiar with the issue, so I'll have to get back to you on that.
Mr. Day, anything?
I'll defer to the Assistant Secretary.
Can I just add one quick? During my last visit to West Africa, interestingly, the President of Guinea said that they had some potential cobalt there, and we're following up on that one.
We could use the extra partnership. It would be helpful to both, and I do not want China once again interfering in a very important memorandum of understanding. So moving on, my colleagues and I have long sought to counter Boko Haram's campaign to use unspeakable violence against schoolgirls to gain international notoriety. Last February, I was appalled to learn that Boko Haram had abducted 112 schoolgirls from a town in northeast Nigeria. While most were thankfully released a month later, one brave little girl, a 15-year-old Leah Sharibu, remains in captivity because she refused to abandon her Christian faith. Ambassador Naj, how is the United States working to secure Leah's safe release?
Leah Sharibu definitely remains a priority for us. Our ambassador is seized with it, as is the rest of the mission. We bring her up, and as a matter of fact, President Buhari himself is following up on that on a continuous basis. One of the things that we have avoided is mentioning it too much in public, because then the value to the terrorists keeps going up. But I can assure you that we are working very energetically as much as possible to obtain her release.
Thank you. Although Rwanda's authoritarian government under Paul Kagame recently acquitted opposition leader Diane Rigaru of trumped-up charges brought against her, many worry that the government's intent is to intimidate its critics and political enemies. Mr. Day, what does Ms. Rigaru's acquittal mean for dissent and free speech in Rwanda?
You know, USAID has been working in Rwanda for quite some time, and with a wide variety of different programs. And you'll have to forgive me; I'll have to look into that particular issue. You know, our primary support has been for the Rwandan people. We certainly have been concerned with some of the closing spaces in Rwanda, but we continue to work with civil society and a variety of different groups to support the people of Rwanda so that they have a voice into their own future. But I will look into that particular issue.
Thank you. A few months after Emmerson Mnangagwa replaced strongman Robert Mugabe as president of Zimbabwe, we have seen disappointingly few improvements. Mr. Day, what is the situation on the ground in Zimbabwe, and how does USAID support the growth of Zimbabwe's civil society?
I'll defer to the Assistant Secretary on the political analysis, but similar to Rwanda, we're certainly very concerned about the political situation in Zimbabwe in terms of an operating space. Our priority, of course, continues to be the support of Zimbabwean people who have had been under tremendous distress for a number of decades. And so our programs are focused on humanitarian assistance and supporting civil society so they, again, can have a voice in their own.
Thank you. Ambassador Naj?
Yes, ma'am. On the ground, the Zimbabwean government is saying some fairly positive things, but we're still waiting for some action on the two laws that I mentioned previously.
Right. All right, well, thank you. I look forward to some responses to some of the questions that I had, and I appreciate your service and your time today. Mr. Chairman, I also, for the last time, yield back. It has been an honor and a privilege to work with you here in Congress.